1, 2, 1, 2, 3, it's story time with a friend Joe. He's got the best story, don't you know? Killing hookers, getting drunk, stop by the cops with hooker in the trunk. It's story time with a friend Joe. Strippers, guns, fire trucks, stories make you go, what the fuck? It's story time with a friend Joe.
Wow, man, I really love that song, guys, man. And you know, you guys do this song so well. All right, you definitely get a story out of me, but it's got to be quick because I got Bible study, and then I gotta go help the homeless. So let's get right into this story, okay, guys?
Yeah. Whatever, Joe. Just give us the fucking story.
What a swell guy.
So, it's nearing the end of the school year and the end of the '80s. Now the '80s were like a cult. Because you can't grasp how bad they were until you're out of them. No doubt, the 80s bestowed us with the third and fourth generation breast implants, the fall of the Berlin Wall, and outlets like MTV to cover said fall. PC spawned the first video games, and we paid for it all with our dignity.
What does your dignity buy?
Silence, if you're lucky.
I doubt there's anybody who survived the 80s without a couple of pictures they'd stab a priest to conceal. The 80s had a style that slapped your ego, hurt your eyes, scarred a generation. Nobody with half a brain would still rock an 80s hairstyle today.
Oh, montage, montage, montage,
boy. Yeah, montage.
Montage? Okay, hit it, Grunk.
1, 2, 1, 2, 3.
So you get a little bit of idea, and the best way I can explain it to you is, so, you see, the 80s are like sleeping with your first cousin. Sure, it feels good while you're doing it, but it's not so good when your mother breaks out the family pictures.
Joe, what happened at the end of the school year?
School ends, and summer starts, marking a whole year with my first long-term girlfriend. She taught me a lot of stuff I never really learned on my own, opening all kinds of new doors. We had a lot in common. She does cheerleading and yoga, and I enjoy watching her do both. She likes ice cream, and so do I. We both live in America, and go to the same school, and speak the same language. Her favorite color is, well, mine is blue. We both love animals, so we got a dog, and named him after our one true interest, music. It's the 80s, so big hair, I don't care, bands are in. We dig all the same band, well, almost. Over the winter, we plan to destroy the summer concert scene. We buy shitloads of tickets. But before we get to show one, we break up. It was over, well, she told me, but I wasn't listening. I did hear one thing loud inside. She was keeping the dog. All seriousness aside, I'm devastated. And none of my other friends broke up with their girlfriends, making me the consummate third wheel. All but one friend. My one bro, Tommy. Because Tommy stays single due to his birth defect.
What kind of birth defect?
It's no fault of his own. It started out when he was really young, and then it just got worse as he got older. Tommy has an uncanny resemblance. Matt Dillon.
Allowing him to hook up with more girls than most guys. Tons of girls. Making the prospects of a long-term relationship seem unappealing.
What?
For years I supported my friend.
Never knowing the comfort of having the same girl, day after day, for months, years even. I put him at ease, pointing out people claimed I resemble Vanilla Ice. But it's just not the same.
Tommy's handicap is something I'm willing to overlook. The same way you overlook co-workers, ridiculous wheelchair accessories, or pretend retarded people aren't funny as fuck.
Wow, Joe. You're like Gandhi.
Yeah, pretty much. But if I'm Gandhi, then Tommy's gotta be Bernardo O'Higgins, because he liberated me from my misery, the way Higgins liberated Chili. With Tommy's help, and lots of parties, I start to put my ex behind me. still sucks. She took my dog, half my music collection, and a good chunk of my social circle, since I don't want to run into her through any mutual friends. Fuck it. Because by now, me and Tommy are tearing up the city like a bad report card. We hit the Orpheum, we hit the Channel, we hit the Rathskeller, the Garden, and then we hit a problem. The next four concerts are in Great Woods, and that's in Mansfield, Mass. For two kids without a car, they might as well be in Kickapoo, Kansas. Growing up in the city, with subways, buses, cars are a low priority. My ex has a car, but she took that, along with my dog, music, friends, and dignity.
After some heavy thinking, it finally hits me. Uncle Randy. Uncle Randy was a guy I wanted to be like as a kid. He never had to work, grew his hair long, played guitar while smoking weed around long-legged women all day. Then you grow up, and it hits you. When you realize he's an unemployed stoner. And besides, when you're only 3 foot tall, any woman over 5 feet has long legs.
Everyone loves Daisy Duke shorts. Randy's no different, apart from the fact he likes to wear them. Let me paint a picture of Uncle Randy for you. He's got this curly blonde fro with a matching bushy mustache, wearing his cut-off shorts and a tank top. And it's never no normal tank top. No, it's got to be bright yellow or fucking magenta with MOPAR written on it. MOPAR standing for Motor, Power, and Response. Highlighting his one redeeming aspect, his car. Uncle Randy doesn't have a normal car. He's got a plum crazy purple Duster, centerline rims, roll bars in the back. Where the back seat normally would be, he's got this crazy airbrushed dragon getting jerked off by a wizard. Well, okay, the dragon's not really being jerked off, but the way his wand is and the way the dragon's placed, it's something we always break Randy's balls over. Tommy doesn't normally get along with Randy. He's only 6 years older than us. He's always mocking his catchphrase saying, "Man," the way he says it, "Man." But I say, who cares? It's only one night. It's not like we're fucking moving in together. Having been to a few shows, we already know it costs about $500 to get fucking drunk at a show. So we prepare by loading up the trunk with a few beers for the parking lot scene. With Randy's car, it should help fill in the second part of our plan, because every guy knows hot women love to lean on cool cars. Science has failed us, unable to figure this one out. But there's lots of evidence to support my claim. We got a ride. Now, with my best friend, Uncle Randy, shorts and all, a trunk full of beer,
music blasting, we are out of here.
It starts raining like the fucking Bible. So we're parked under an overpass while Randy explains his fucking wipers don't work. This is the problem with Randy. He's got this mental muscle car. An insane stereo, crazy rims, money for an erotic airbrush scene, but no money to get his wipers fixed. In the middle of our heated debate, Randy starts laughing when he tells us there is one way we can make it. It turns out, this Duster has an actuary swing lever arm bullshit. It's under the dash, above the gas pedals, and yeah, between Randy's legs. Fuck no, everybody says. After another 10 minutes of arguing, no sign of the rain letting up, we got two choices. We can either start gathering two of everything and build a fucking ark, or I can get down on the floor and start fucking using the wipers by hand. Another thing the Duster doesn't have is air conditioning. And since it's raining, the windows are rolled up. So I'm down on the floor between Randy's legs, sweating my balls off. Speaking of balls, every time I look up, I get a face full of Uncle Crotch. Still baffles my mind why girls want to lean on these things.
I'm stoked in humidity, while drenched in humility, as the unlikely duo bond over the idea it's me, not them on the floor, jerking the Duster off at 70 miles per hour. Faster, Joe. Don't stop. Almost there, what I'd have to listen to for the next 20 miles. We hit the parking lot and waste no time liberating the beers from the trunk.
Four beers down, it's going all wrong. Instead of ladies, we're attracting motorheads. No, not that kind. So instead of this, we got this. Guys begin surrounding the car. They ask questions like, how fast does she go? What size engine does she have? And dude, is that wizard touching the dragon's business? It's a big letdown. But we got a trunk full of beer, so fuck it, right?
Apart from the sausage symposium congregating around Randy's dude magnet, steady stream of kids with dirty mustaches parade past offering weed and acid shrooms for the show. Last year, a couple of friends got burned buying fake acid outside of the garden, forever infecting my trust in lot dealers. It's an easy scam to run, because by the time you realize you got screwed, you're inside. Well, the fuckbag who got you is counting his cash outside. Goes to show you how bad things are when you can't trust a psst come here from a complete stranger in a dim-lit area. One of these mud skippers is drawn to Randy's purple man candy, sweetened by the prospects of dragon erotica on display. Every decent buzz, seeing me and Tommy are smashing beers like we're online for adult circumcision. Half out of curiosity, half out of drunken belligerence, ask this dude what he's selling. He produces what I'm convinced is a solid gram rabbit shit, wrapped in thick plastic, followed by a quarter of mushrooms that look like they came from aisle 5 in any fucking supermarket. Tommy and Randy agree, no fucking way, but not me. Drunk, disappointed with the turnout of women, still not completely over having to stroke off the duster for the last 20 miles, only to have the sun pop out like a family member in the days after you strike the lottery, I decide I'm gonna fuck with this dude. Fuck you and have a nice day, I tell him. Everyone gives me a what the fuck look, sees me being a dick. What I see is me committing a noble act on behalf of everyone who's ever been ripped off by this kind of fuckery, like a Che Rivera or Mother Teresa fighting against the distribution of fake drugs outside of concerts. Someday, my face will be embedded on tapestries and t-shirts worn by hippies and college students and hung in dorm rooms across the country. Until then, we grab a few beers and head towards the front gate. In tow, following us like Twitter, the whole time hounding me to give back his shit, is this dude. Persistent fucking nag so deep, Tommy and Randy are on his side. Seeing this, he makes a last ditch plea for me to give back his counterfeit drugs. I hit the three of them with my best defense. Why? So he can go rip someone else off? I mean, this is all I've got. After 12 beers, I'm not exactly Johnny fucking Cochran. Tommy and Randy shrug collectively, saying, yeah, sure, who gives a fuck? I'm about to hand over his ship, and the golf cart cop swings down our lane, heading our way. The dude surprises the shit out of all of us when he tells me, I'm gonna tell the cops you robbed me. That shit fucking hits my fucking switch. I start yelling, I mean screaming so bad, a little piece of spittle flies out my mouth and lands on his beak. The cop car swings around, but before they reach us, the dude pulls a fucking Harry Potter and poof! I always planned on handing over his lunch, or whatever the fuck he gave me. A hard thing to do when he's gone. Fuck it, dude gone, we head inside, find our seats. Having never attended a show where me and Tommy were both smashed walking the gate, there's no way I know how he'd react. The opening band takes the stage, so I'm as shocked as everyone around us when the people in the next 20 rows, when he jumps up screaming,
yeah, motherfucker, woo-hoo, and fuck yeah!
No one else is even tapping their feet when Tommy screams,
arms wailing, full fits of rock and roll hooly hoo.
Fuck the band on stage, with Tommy making a public spectacle of himself, he becomes the main event as the first 20 rows turn their attention to us. When no one rises to match his excitement for Aldo Nova's opening song, Tommy turns his enthusiasm on the crowd, becoming a violent cheerleader for the band, asking,
what's wrong with you fucks? Get up, you fucking pussies!
This is all taking place as the umpteen bears I shotgun in the parking lot quietly sneak up on me to kick my ass. It's always a bad idea to drink on an empty stomach, so I countered this by eating half the bag of shrooms, while at the same time making my point to Randy that they were fake. Not taking into account the idea they also might not be healthy. It's hard enough to melt diamonds under the pavilion. Everything starts to spin like an Aldo Nova Ferris wheel. Unsure how long Tommy can keep up his momentum, while at the same time absolutely positive I don't want to throw up under the scrutiny of hundreds of people watching him. Tommy flies into a deeper rage, now calling out specific people for not joining in with his rock and roll aerobics, opting instead to stare at us. Soon no one's looking at us, apart from event staff. I convince Tommy to go for a walk around with me for a bit, so I can get right, and the walk gets me crisp and ready to party. I've also learned a few things on the walk. So we make our way back to Randy and tell him about our plan. It's good enough? Even a guy like Randy's down. We move into action.
Our seats are between the grass area and the front section.
Now there's a lot of interesting stuff going on back on the grass, but it's too far away. But walking around, I noticed, so long as you don't stop and gawk, nobody has to see your ticket down front. Keep it moving like you're lost or looking for your seat, and you're good. We only have to do this until we find some open seats. Within the first 10 minutes, me and Tommy spot two smoking hot chicks in leather pants, leaving their second row seats, two seats in from the aisle. Fucking sweet, right? Almost. Problem is, Randy is still floating, and he's that ride. We lose him, get separated, and run the risk of walking home, and that's a big fuck that. We're trying to keep an open communication with him, without being obvious. Long gone are the feelings of being sick. The bogus shrooms haven't killed me yet, and I'm amped up. So long as I don't wind up Tommy into another rock and roll, hoochie coo, woo hoo, let's rock and roll fit, we'll be fine. Randy is floating periodically, we hear his trademark call, man. For the first time since this misadventure began, I'm having fun. Feeling great. Can't stop smiling. Whenever I spot Randy, instead of shooting him the look of concern, I start cracking up in his yellow shirt, tight ass shorts, with his discerning look of, I need a seat, man. And it's fucking hilarious. If for only me. It's 1, 2, 3, and the Scorpions take the stage. I turn around, to my relief, Randy's landed his seat 12 rows back. Tommy leaps up doing his yahoo rock and roll.
Hoo-hoo!
This time, he's not alone, and it's not only me with him. Everyone's jamming. Caught up in the roar of it all. Seeing the band for the first time, and not on MTV, I'm such a fanboy still, and the lights are seriously fucking with me. Whenever a band member moves, a trail of lights follow him. It's hilarious. And unnerving. And then I'm hit with anxiety, because the lights are going wide, then narrow, dim, and then bright.
Dude, I'm fucking tripping,
Tommy tells me, and it hits me.
Me too, boom boom.
Without a word, we move up as close to the front as we can get. Drunk, on shrooms, Tommy's ripping, roar, rah, no one says a word to us. We're caught up in the excitement, enough to be jamming with the band. We're 5 feet away, and only 4 feet up. When the guitar slides over to say what's up, dude flips out his bottom lip, bobs his head, staring at us, jamming on his guitar, and a pair of leather pants that make Randy look like a fucking Mormon. The dude is jamming away, swaying his hips, thrashing and thrusting his codpiece in our faces, and something clicks. The lights, the drugs, the beers, the roaring crowd, and the grown man towering over us in tight leather pants. We came to the show in hopes of something like this, or that. Instead, we get a 30-something-year-old man in tight leather pants packing a card piece, bouncing his junk in our mugs. In all honesty, I'm positive, we're not exactly what he was hoping for in the front row either. As though we share one mind, me and Tommy stop moving and stare at each other and share a what-the-fuck moment. In a nanosecond, we both come to our own conclusions. Tommy told me later his was to buy a pair of leather pants. For me, it was realizing these guys are just regular guys. Guys who really dig leather pants, but all the same, regular guys.
Turn back to the stage, unsure how to respond to our first encounter with the smiling man in leather pants. So we begin yelling shit, screaming as loud as we can, unloading our double-barreled diatribe. Dude looks down at us, throwing a fit, and moves even closer. Drops down, laying into his guitar, killing that shit. Schools us on how to rock a show. Smiles at us, shoots us one of these, and he's gone. We explode into laughter, realizing he can't hear a word we're screaming. From where he's standing, we look like two fucking tools. I rant more like this. The pants took us by surprise. As it hits us, Scorpions only sing songs about three things: parties, women, and breaking up with said women.
In all fairness, gotta highlight how cool it was of Rudolph to even come over and jam for us two fucking retards. Been to a lot of shows, seen a lot of guys play guitar, and I gotta tell you, not a lot of guys give a fuck about male fans. Rudy did. That, my friend, is cool as fuck.
Out of breath, we make our way back to our seats. We spot Randy in the seats right behind us, where he was lucky enough to find some woman, let him sit on her lap, or the other way around. We're taking in the show. The band's playing great. We're having fun like we set out to do. But even better, when Tommy turns to me, his fist balled up, vein in his forehead throbbing to the beat, he tells me,
"Dude, so fucking help me, Joe, if I turn around and that girl is standing up."
Confused, I turn back around to see what the fuck he's talking about, and I catch Uncle Randy's beaming smile covered with his bushy mustache and his, "Oh man." I smile and nod to the cute girl he's sitting with when I realize she's not sitting on his lap, nor is he on hers. She's standing up. And a crowd of thousands,
Randy managed to find the one little person and took her seat. She's weaving side to side, her little hair swaying to the song. I whips back around, eyes wide with laughter, and I get hit with codpiece pantaloons against the image of Randy's bunga hair, bushy stash, shitting smile, and his little friend dancing away. Back to Tommy, who's fucking heated, tells me,
"Dude, he's got a midget. I swear, Joe. I know he's your uncle, but I want to beat his ass."
His fist ball, veins throbbing to the beat. I'm off. I mean, I don't know what to do. I'm not even sure that this is fucking happening. I look again, and yep, sure enough, little person in back, leather crotch up front, angry friend to my right, and rock and roll all over. From nowhere, the words to calm Tommy down come to me like divine wisdom in one sentence. I didn't even mean the word the way I did when I tell him.
"So what? Let him get a little piece of ass."
Tommy's rage melts and we dissolve into laughter, and we spend the next two songs laughing harder than I've ever laughed at this point in my life.
The rest of the show rocks. We've long since gotten over the fear of leather pants, and come to find out, we owe the seats we parked our asses in to Rudolph as well. When the guys next to us tell us, when the band first took the stage, Rudolph called the two leather-clad hotties backstage, leaving us their seats. To that, I say thank you, sir. Hearing this has always made me wonder if maybe he mistook us for their boyfriends and was mocking us. Well, to that, I guess we'll never know. But who cares? We're having fun. The band rocks, and I'm with people I care about. And then, it happens.
I did my 20 miles, stroking off Randy's duster to be here.
The world is closing in.
The band plays Wind of Change.
You never think that we could be so close, like brothers.
Dude sings those lyrics right there. Me, Randy, Tommy, Randy's little friend. The lights, the song, even the stoner from the fucking parking lot. Everything comes together. Peace, it's love, it's something I can't explain. I don't have the language and the skills and the comedy to tell you what it was. It's a calm, and it was phenomenal. Yeah, fuck that. My ex, stolen dog, my problems, everything is gone. Cause that's what music does. As corny as it sounds, that's love. Good music, close friends. In that moment, you feel alive. The music breaks down the walls, pulls us together. It's that universal language that we all understand. Because in music, you can find yourself and identify and say, yeah, I dig it. That's what it's about. So fuck the 80s, the bad style, magenta shirts, and horrific hair. A couple of songs, a little piece of music, the good friends, and that moment. When you're alive and everything comes together, it's beautiful. Cause the next day, life comes back and the good feelings fade. The bills to pay, work sucks, landlord's at your door, or your boss is accusing you of shitting on the men's room floor. Again, regardless of what genre of music you listen to, music gives us an escape hatch. A shelf to place our daily stress upon momentarily. Thank you, Scorpion, for rocking my little piece of the world, sharing your songs with us, and giving me a story that 25 years later is still as funny and meaningful as it was back then. And that's more than I can say about most of the stuff that came out of the 80s. I'm gonna cut this short. While filing out of the show, a minor fight breaks out, and when the ambulances arrive, I meet a cute paramedic. She sees what I'm up against with Randy and Tommy, still arguing over the fight that ensues. And after a couple of Randy jokes, we hit it off. Turns out, we like a lot of the same bands. She has good taste in music. You know what else she has? A car. So we end up hitting a couple of shows together, blossoming into a decent little romance. I even found out a little something about myself that summer. Enough to learn something,
And I did something. I took a risk. Went against my better judgment. We got a dog. And I'm still friends with that person to this day. That was my summer. I hope you enjoyed it. I did.